Good morning. My name is Sean Scapoletto, and I'm an attorney at Cobb, Dill, and Hammett Law Firm in Mount Pleasant, South Carolina. We are a firm that deals with most major areas of the law, and one of the areas I deal in most is real estate law, some corporate and banking, and a little bit of criminal defense. But the First Amendment is an area that is extremely important to me, primarily because in a former life I was a high school teacher and worked a lot with young people. And as anyone can imagine, in a school setting, First Amendment rights are constantly at the forefront, particularly if you were, like I was, dealing with a student newspaper or a publication. And so as I morphed into the law, the First Amendment still remained an interest of mine, and so it was a great pleasure to put together some of the basics as far as First Amendment law goes with regard to social media. Social media is a phenomenon that has really proliferated in the last 15 years, and we haven't quite codified it yet. However, I can give you a basic working definition. Social media being a computer-mediated technology that allows for the creating and sharing of information, ideas, interests, other forms of expression, okay? Key word being expression. You're probably very familiar with Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, Instagram, LinkedIn, things like that. And social media is probably one of the key modes of communication for young people. And so when you try to put social media in context, we got to talk about the world at large, all right? Population, world population, tipping out at about 7.3 billion people. And this was in, these are 2015 numbers, so probably even bigger now. There are approximately 3 billion internet users worldwide, and that number continues to grow. And 2.3 billion of those people are using social media and using it regularly. About 79% of all internet users are on Facebook now. 68% of U.S. adults are on Facebook. I was on it this morning. So when you consider that, and then you start looking at the generational breakdown, I'm a Gen Xer. But the millennial generation seems to be the ones who are the power users, if you will, of social media. In fact, some people term them the like generation for the Facebook thing. But 89% of the millennial generation are active social media users. And so a couple other things that you might find interesting about social media is how fast it has grown. Social media users have risen by 176 million people in just the last year. About a million new active users added every day, and that equates to about 12 each second. It's pretty amazing. Facebook Messenger, the instant messenger form that Facebook utilizes, 60 billion messages a day. And the numbers continue to grow. I remember watching the Social Network movie, the Aaron Sorkin screenplay, and that the landmark was landing, 500,000 Facebook users. Well, we've got 1.71 billion Facebook users, and this is a company that was founded only 13 years ago. 320 million Twitter users, and that is a company that was founded only about 11 years ago. And then in the professional arena, LinkedIn is an up-and-comer, a fast riser for people wanting to network, not in a social sense, but in a professional sense. And there are already 450 million LinkedIn users. So there's no question that social media is here to stay. It's going to continue to grow. And the real question then becomes is what impact does that have on the law? And what impact does that have on say, your First Amendment rights to free expression. One of the things that people like to talk about with regard to the millennials is the way that they think about the world. And it's interesting to ponder this idea. I have kids myself. My kids have never known a world without an internet. They've never known a world without a cell phone. I thought this was an interesting statistic. If you ask a millennial, 65% of them will say that losing their phone or their computer would be worse than losing their car. The other things with relation to expression and speech is that 40% of millennials support restricting offensive speech if it involves derogatory language about minority groups. The millennial generation seems to have a greater acceptance and universality in their mindset. And I can say this having had direct contact with young people for the last 23 years. It's been an interesting evolution. when you consider the millennial generation, power users of social media, and the context of the law, that kind of sets us up for what I'm talking about today with you, which is the impact of social media on the First Amendment. And so how are First Amendment rights impacted by the use of social media? The courts are still forming answers to these questions. For example, this quarter, first quarter of 2017, the United States Supreme Court is hearing multiple First Amendment cases with regard to social media and things like freedom of religion. And so the law continues to evolve on this. It is not hard and fast. In fact, I'd venture to say that some of the stuff that I'll be talking about today may be old law in as little as 6 months. However, the foundations that we'll discuss today will still remain the same. And so it's important to understand, you know, where we've been in order to understand where we're going. There is a slide that I've put in on freedom of speech and talks about the framers of the Bill of Rights discussing First Amendment, and it's interesting the way that, you know, the First Amendment, I guess you could say it's about any of the amendments, but the First Amendment being the right to be a pain in the neck for somebody, you know, because it's always, you know, anytime speech gets curtailed, then there's often a very swift and response, and it's often somebody trying to be a pain in the neck to somebody else. But the key is we live in one of the only countries in the world that allows for us to think freely and to speak freely, and the right to do so is part of the very foundation of our country. If we were to look at the history of of free speech and its evolution, because I was a teacher and because I respect history and literature, I thought it would be interesting to see what kind of speech existed on this topic before we had the framers of the Constitution codifying the Bill of Rights. You have statements like Socrates at his trial in 399 BC saying, you know, if you don't let me speak my mind, then, you know, I'd rather be dead. Erasmus saying, in a free state, tongues too should be free. Even the great poet John Milton says that anyone who destroys a good book kills reason itself. I believe that our framers of the Constitution knew of these texts, knew of these thoughts, and I think some of this we can actively trace as being foundational with regard to how James Madison, for example, thought when he penned the Bill of Rights. There's the famous quote by Voltaire saying that, you know, it sometimes gets changed a little bit, but, you know, I detest what you write, but I would give my life to make it possible for you to continue to write. And that right there is a nice encapsulation of what the First Amendment says. On slide 11, I've even put in a recent case. This was the ACLU versus Janet Reno in 1997, where The court actually said that the internet is entitled to the highest level of First Amendment protection. They equated the internet with all print media, and that was a huge statement. And that becomes now sort of a springboard from which most of the First Amendment law comes. Well, we've been talking quite a bit about the First Amendment. I guess we should talk about what it says. If we were to pull out the Constitution right now and look at it, the First Amendment's going to say that Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, or abridging the freedom of the press or of the press. Freedom of speech or of the press, or the right to peaceably assemble or to petition the government. There are five freedoms embedded in that. Now we're going to concentrate on freedom of speech, and we're kind of adding another layer in there as to social media. But that's the First Amendment. When we talk about freedom of speech, most people think of it in a political context. This idea that we should be able to talk about our leaders without fear of being jailed or punished. And these political times, the First Amendment gets tossed around quite a bit, particularly after a contentious election where everybody is voicing their opinions, and in some cases very strongly. The also in freedom of speech is this idea to disagree, say, with what the majority thought is, or whatever ideas are vogue. You often hear about the majority of one idea. These ideas all come back to freedom of speech. And if you look at our history, there are going to be cases where free speech is curtailed, or you can't say maybe anything that you want to say. This gets into some of the ideas of society or social contract. There's the famous idea that, you can't walk into a crowded theater and yell fire and create mass chaos if indeed there is no fire. So there are going to be times when the interests of, say, government interests or societal interests can trump the ability to speak freely. In law school, they teach you, well, what are all those exceptions? If there's a law, then you can count on there being a long list of exceptions, right? So we know that, for example, obscene speech is not protected under the First Amendment. Defamatory speech, you can't say things about people that aren't true in such a way that it defames their character. We know that things like pornography or indecent expression are not protected by the First Amendment. We've learned about fighting words, certain types of interactions that are intended to provoke a violent response. You can't perjure yourself under oath. You can't blackmail people. So these are all examples of ways in which speech can be curtailed in the greater interest of society. On slide 15, you'll see the last bullet there is a like on Facebook considered a freedom or an expression protected under the First Amendment. Hold that thought. We're going to come back to that later. But in the context of social media, that becomes a very interesting question. Talking about ways in which speech can be curtailed, in talking about millennials and in talking about the First Amendment, schools become probably the first thing that comes to mind. I worked in schools for over two decades, free speech is something that kids talk about constantly. Because if you think about it, you have young people in an environment where being able to express oneself is key to your identity. And teenagers, I was once one, like to push the envelope. I certainly push the envelope. And so I'm going to show you some of the precedent cases, and you're going to see some examples where kids have tested the limits of First Amendment expression. And it's interesting because, you know, kids say the darndest things, but also it's forced the courts to grapple with some very important questions. And so you get out on the periphery of these issues a little bit, and the courts then start defining what that periphery is, what the edges look like. And so no matter what happens with First Amendment speech, it's really interesting to trace this back to some of the bedrock cases, some of the black letter law. And I'm dealing with public schools because under the First Amendment, we're talking about government actors. And so a public school is part of the state government. And so the First Amendment applies to them, not necessarily in the same way it would to a private school or a private employer. Okay, but we'll start with some of the public school cases. Perhaps the most famous and the one that sets the standard under South Carolina law is the Tinker case, Tinker versus Des Moines. On slide 16, there's a picture of two kids holding up black armbands with peace signs on them. This case came before the Supreme Court in 1969, and I'll outline the facts for you briefly. You had Christopher Eckhart, a 16-year-old, Mary Beth Tinker, a 13-year-old, and her brother John, who was a 15-year-old, all were suspended from school because they were wearing these black armbands in protest of the Vietnam War, which was probably almost at its height in 1969. And so the school suspended them, said that, you know, you guys are creating a real, you know, disturbance here. Or actually, they said that they were afraid they were going to create quite a disturbance with their behavior. And so they suspended them until they said, until you come back without the armbands on. So the kids pursued their legal remedies and with the help of their families and lawyers, and the lower courts dismissed their claims. They said that, you know, the schools were right to act the way they did because the interest was preventing the kind of disturbance to the school environment that would have probably occurred had they remained in school. And on the flip side of that argument, the kids were saying, well, no, these are considered expressions, pure speech under the law, and they should be allowed to wear them. And so those are sort of the two sides of the coin there. The case eventually made its way all the way to the Supreme Court. It's interesting, I'm going to skip over to slide 19, what the Supreme Court had to say about this. There are some famous quotes that come out of this that might sound familiar to you. The first one being that young men and women do not lose their fundamental rights just because they are students. And the central question to this is a student afforded the same rights in a school setting that, say, they would be afforded outside of a school setting? In other words, can schools curtail the speech of students under our First Amendment rights abridged here? Another quote that comes out of this is that students or teachers do not shed their constitutional rights to freedom of speech or expression at the schoolhouse gate. You don't suddenly give up all your rights when you walk through those gates. So the court did come out with what the standard would be. And so here's where they land on this issue, is that if the speech would materially and substantially interfere with the requirements of appropriate discipline in the operation of the school, then the speech can be curtailed. Okay? And so what you have to have here is putting in the context of these facts, is was the wearing of the armbands substantially and materially disrupting the discipline of the school, the operation of the school? All right, the Supreme Court says no, it did not. They said that you can't necessarily curtail the speech because you're afraid that it could disrupt the school. the operation of the school. Back on slide 18, I have the bullet saying that the fear of disturbance is not enough. It's also interesting to note in the context here that that while the school said that the kids couldn't wear the black armbands, they were permitting other expressions like political buttons, iron crosses, and those kids were not suspended for what they were wearing. So that was another factor that weighed in. And so the Tinker standard is what we sometimes call it, and I know that that applies under First Amendment expression here in South Carolina, is the material and substantial disruption of the operation of the school or the discipline of the school. And the anticipation of it is not enough. So most of these First Amendment questions can be answered under this Tinker standard. All right, the next case is an interesting one. It's the Bethel case, Bethel School District versus Frazier. This case came down in 1986. This case came about when I was in high school, and it was actually, I remember it being in the news. This was a case where a student stood up and made a speech full of sexual innuendo in front of the student body. The facts are like this. Matthew Frazier, he was a senior. He wrote a speech that was sort of putting up his friend Jeff Kuhlman for president of the student body. So he was making his endorsement of his friend, and he decided that it would be funny if he made the speech with a bunch of double entendres in it. There were 600 students in a school assembly who heard the speech. The facts say that most people found it to be really funny. However, other people were offended by it. The school's reaction was to suspend him immediately. They banned him from speaking at graduation. They said you violated the school's disciplinary code. The facts say that that at graduation, the school allowed the students to select who would be the speaker for the students, and so apparently Mr. Frazier was voted overwhelmingly by his peers to be that speaker, and so as a result of the speech, though, he was then prevented from doing that. And so he, too, availed himself of his judicial options and took the school district to court. And at the district level, the courts found in favor of Frazier, saying that it was indistinguishable from the Tinker case, saying that by suspending him or preventing him from speaking at graduation, they were violating his First Amendment rights to free expression. The disciplinary code that the school had was vague and overbroad, that it didn't necessarily address what had happened here. And they also said that by removing him from his ability to speak at graduation, they were violating his due process rights under the 14th Amendment. And so this was appealed up to the Court of Appeals. The Ninth Circuit affirmed the district court's ruling, and then they petitioned the Supreme Court to hear it. The Supreme Court agreed to hear it in 1986, and I've got on slide 23 several of the key statements that arise out of this case. And so here, the one of the key things that you see in Bethel is the constitutional analysis, where you're weighing the First Amendment rights to free expression with the governmental interest in protecting students and keeping the sort of sanctity of the teaching atmosphere. And so this quote saying that this freedom to advocate what might be unpopular or controversial views has to be balanced against society's countervailing interest in teaching students and the boundaries of what's socially appropriate. And if, you know, in this balance, you know, does it come under strict scrutiny or a rational basis analysis? The other key point here is that high school assembly or classroom is not the correct time or place for a sexually explicit monologue directing toward an unsuspecting audience. And so Where the court landed on this one is that public schools can curtail First Amendment rights, can regulate the speech, because if it's plainly offensive, it undermines the school's basic mission to educate, teetering a little close to the idea of obscene speech. Now you're probably wondering, what on earth did he say? You know, how bad was it, right? And I've got a slide. Slide 24 are some excerpts from the speech of Mr. Frazier made about his friend Mr. Kuhlman. And I'm not going to read this to you, but you can take a look at it. And I, you know, when I look at this, it strikes me as something that I might have done when I was 16. It strikes me as typical teenager behavior. I'm not passing judgment on it one way or the other, but there's no doubt that the speech has that sexual innuendo, and that if it makes sense to you when you read it, that, you know, it probably made sense to a lot of the teenagers who heard it. And so this is so that's the speech itself on slide 24. You can draw your own conclusions here as to whether the court was right. But the key finding out of the Bethel case is that schools can regulate speech as it occurs on school grounds, and if the school finds it to be plainly offensive. And there it does sort of align with Tinker in the sense that plainly offensive speech, by logical extension, would disrupt the school environment and the environment and the operation of the school and the discipline of the school. The third key case I want to bring up with you is the Hazelwood case, and you can imagine we went from a student speech now to student newspaper, what's in writing. The Hazelwood case, just a couple years after Bethel, becomes sort of the key school newspaper case. Can a school regulate what is written by students in the paper? Another key question: are student writers afforded the same First Amendment protection that, say, a professional writer in a newspaper would be? So this is the Hazelwood case versus Kuhlmeier. This was a case where a student newspaper writers basically published two controversial articles in a school paper. Other facts that might be relevant here is that the school paper was not a class, not mandatory. It was voluntary, extracurricular activity for the students who were on the staff, and they had published an article on teen pregnancy, and they had published another article on the effect of divorce on kids. And slide 26 has a screenshot of what the articles look like when they were published. And what happened here is once the paper came out, the school administrators pulled it from distribution. So again, this makes its way through the through the court system, and the idea came down that school officials could censor articles and could curtail student speech, but where's the limit? Okay, and so on slide 27, I've got the Hazelwood standard there for you. School officials can regulate school-sponsored student speech if there is a reasonable educational reason for doing so. And here, with regard to the articles, one of the key components that the court looked at was in the article on teen pregnancy, there was a sort of an implicit sanctioning of teenage premarital sex. And in the article on the divorce, on the effects of divorce on children, they had interviewed a parent on the effects of divorce, and the opposing viewpoint was never offered. And so the court looked at this as a way of saying, well, it wasn't a completely unbiased viewpoint, and so because of these considerations, among many others, they felt like that the adults could, the school administrators could censor the articles. And the court backed them up on this. Again, the Tinker standard was considered, and they looked. The court also looked at Bethel because the speech occurred on campus, and so this was ended up being an important case because the answer to the question is that student writers are not afforded the same First Amendment protection that professional writers would be under the First Amendment. And here, administrators in a school are given a little more latitude because they do have to justify it under a reasonable educational standard, but reasonable educational value standard. But beyond that, the students should be able to write what they want. They should be able to express themselves the way they want. The last case I want to talk to you about with regard to schools has to do with the Morris versus Frederick case. This one came about, the facts were that in 2002, this was a school in Alaska. The Olympic torch was being run through Juneau, and so this particular school had its students out on the street to watch the torch come by. One student decided that it would be really funny to create this banner and hold it up while the torch runners and the entourage came by. And so slide 29 has the actual photograph of the actual banner. And it says "Bong Hits for Jesus." So this, the Morris case, has become known as the "Bong Hits for Jesus" case. When they asked this particular student, "What did you mean with this banner?" He goes, "I have no idea." He says, "I just thought it would be funny." So there was no hidden message in this. I think he just wanted to create something that that would be sort of pushing that envelope on free speech and expression and just see what would happen. And I guess he probably thought it was really funny. And so anyhow, he displayed this banner. The school suspended him too. Some interesting facts are that he was not in school that day and that the banner that he was holding, he was holding it across the street. And so technically he was not on school grounds. So here's a case where the question becomes, can the school actually regulate his behavior and his expression if he's not in attendance in school that day and if his behavior is occurring off school grounds? Now, this leads us into some interesting implications with social media, which we're going to get to. But this case had questions at stake here that extend beyond Tinker or Hazelwood or Frazier. So anyway, when this hit the district court level, Frederick lost. The Ninth Circuit reversed and found for Frederick, and then it makes its way to the Supreme Court to settle the case. They agreed to hear it in 2007. And here you're going to find sort of a holding that leans a little bit on the Hazelwood case. Because schools may take steps to safeguard those entrusted to their care from speech that can reasonably be regarded as encouraging illegal drug use, school officials didn't violate the First Amendment by taking the banner and suspending the student. And so here it was not necessarily founded on the disruption to the school or the fear of disruption to the educational environment. It wasn't offensive speech in Bethel that occurred on campus. They couldn't use the Bethel standard. But leaning on Hazelwood a little bit, this advocacy argument, you know, you can't advocate premarital sex. You can't advocate illegal drug use to students because of the effect that it can have on this mission to safeguard our students. And so here the Supreme Court falls on the idea that, again, First Amendment rights can be curtailed there. But interesting finding for the stint from the standpoint that the school was actually able to regulate speech that occurred off its campus. Now, granted, it was during school hours, but you know, as we get into social media cases, this becomes one of the central questions. You know, can something on Facebook that is posted off campus, not during school hours, be actually regulated by the school? All right, and that's kind of where we're headed. On slide 31, we get into some of this stuff. I've found some interesting cases and circumstances that sort of explore this idea. In Tulsa, Oklahoma, a student was suspended for sending a tweet with a racial slur in reference to the Baltimore riots that were occurring a few years ago. And then also in Tulsa, a group of students were suspended for vandalism and online posts that were bashing other gay students. And nine students were suspended who liked the post. Here in Charleston, there was a student expelled from school after sending a Snapchat that made a racial slur. And these are cases that didn't necessarily get into the court system. However, what you're seeing here are schools grappling with these issues and oftentimes suspending and expelling those students. And the underlying idea here is, you know, are these types of things First Amendment expressions, or is it the kind of speech not protected under First Amendment for reasons of obscenity or disrupting the school environment, or, you know, somehow compromising the school's mission to educate students? I've got two cases on slide 32 that kind of address the social media aspect. They're interesting because they come out of the same appeals district, and they initially come to different conclusions. The Layshock case and the Blue Mountain School case. In Layshock, you have a high school senior who created this online parody of their principal. It was sort of one of those parodies, satiric but not insulting necessarily. Again, we're getting into subjective areas where it kind of depends on the viewpoint of the listener or the person seeing the video. But the student was suspended for 10 days and forced to finish school at an alternative school. In the Blue Mountain School case, you had back when MySpace was still a prevalent form of social media, you had an eighth grader who was he had created a fake profile of the school principal, and in this particular one said some pretty offensive things about the school principal. And the Third Circuit Court of Appeals heard both of these cases. And it's interesting. They ruled that in the Layshock case, the online parody, the student's First Amendment rights were violated. And they used the Tinker standard here. The Fraser standard was inappropriate because the speech did not occur on school grounds. But under the Tinker standard, there was no disruption to the school. There was no disruption to the learning environment. And so they used the Tinker standard to say that, well, while this might have been controversial or subjectively considered offensive by some, it did not disrupt the sanctity of the school environment, and so the speech had to be permitted. In the Blue Mountain School District case, they used the Tinker standard, but they came to a different conclusion, that the speech there was slightly more controversial, slightly more offensive, crossed a line that the court didn't necessarily elucidate, but one that said that, well, here we can regulate this speech. And so what ended up happening is that the Third Circuit reheard it en banc, and they came up with a ruling that sort of aligned or harmonized both cases, and that was by what I just said, using the Tinker standard, but finding that one did create a disruption because it was a little bit more offensive, and using the actual facts of the case, this in the Blue Mountain case, the the school environment had the facts of that case showed a lot more disruption to the school environment. And then the lay shot case where it really had no effect whatsoever, the speech was permitted. So they sort of align the cases that way using the Tinker standard. And so, you know, when it comes to the school environment, Tinker and Bethel and Hazelwood and Morris, those four cases, still really apply, and we can see how those cases are used to help the court arrive at their decision, even in Layshock and Blue Mountain, where you have uses of social media. Okay, so that's schools. All right, we'll circle back to that a little bit later. But the other context where social media has a direct effect is in an employment situation. And so these next cases I'm going to go through with you have to do with employees and social media and whether or not employees can be subject to discipline by the employer based on things that they might say online. We're going to look at some of the foundational cases here as well, so you can see how the law kind of evolved on this matter. And so that's where we're going next. I have a quote by Oliver Wendell Holmes, slide 34. An employee may have a constitutional right to talk politics, but he has no constitutional right to be employed. And that was an interesting statement, definitely applies here. On slide 35, you can call in sick, but later if you post a Facebook selfie of yourself at a Cubs game, you will be fired. That actually happened. And I think that one probably goes without saying. The couple other examples for you, an employee fired from her insulation packing job in 2004 because of a John Kerry bumper sticker on her car back when John Kerry was running for president. Is that an appropriate response by an employer? We have Michael Itali fired because he appeared on local radio to discuss socialist views, and his bid for Miami mayor on the Socialist Workers Party ticket. I'm sort of raising these questions here without necessarily answering them. Here you have another in the next one. An employee fired in 2014 from his job as an English teacher because he wrote a blog post about homophones. And homophones, these are words that sound the same but are spelled differently. But apparently it was interpreted as having something to do with the promoting of a gay agenda, which is completely off base and inaccurate here, but fired for it anyway on a blog post. And so these are the kinds of situations that, say, employees are seeing with regard to social media. And so we need to sort through what do the courts say about these kinds of things and these kinds of cases that have actually made their way through the court system. We know that just like I said with schools, that as this relates to employers, these need to be state actors. They need to be state government employers and government employees. And we know that a state actor cannot violate any individual's civil rights under the First Amendment. Okay. On slide 38, you see that the Civil Rights Act of 1964 does relate to private businesses. So it doesn't mean that, you know, anyone can discriminate if you're not a governmental actor. Private businesses can't discriminate under the Civil Rights Act of 1964 if they offer public accommodations and if they're discriminating on the basis of race, color, religion, and national origin. We know that Title VII protects private employers from discriminating on the basis of gender. Then we also have labor laws. The National Labor Relations Act, the NLRA, allows private employees to engage in concerted activity. That's a key phrase there, activities with other people to address working conditions and workplace issues, and that would be protected under the NLRA. And so there are lots of ways in which private employers are prevented from discriminating. And some of what we'll talk about today has to do with private employers, but then under public employers, government actors, we know that the First Amendment prevents any discrimination from happening there, all right, through the 14th. The first case I'll share with you is the Pickering case. This is on slide 39. This is a case that occurred just a little bit before the Tinker case, so it's kind of interesting in that context. You have a fellow by the name of Marvin Pickering. He was a public school teacher, and he had basically written a letter to the editor. And in his letter to the editor, he was criticizing the local school board for whom he worked. He accused them, in among other things, of mishandling money. He accused the superintendent of threatening people who had opposed a bond issue that had come up before the school board, and consequently was fired for this letter. They said that his letter or his behavior was detrimental to the efficient operation and administration of the schools in the district, and the courts found that that they were right, at least initially. They said that that Pickering's claim of First Amendment expression and violation of his civil rights through the 14th Amendment were not valid here, and that his employers were right to fire him. The U.S. Supreme Court agreed to hear the case and did so in March of 1968. And here you had a holding 8-1, incidentally, saying that a state employee may express his opinions publicly about matters of public importance. That was the key phrase there, without being fired or disciplined for it. So that his rights were violated based on the letter to the editor, because the things he was talking about, the things he was criticizing the school board for, and the superintendent, were matters of public importance. They related to everybody. And so this was a overwhelming ruling by the court. And they did say that you're not allowed to make reckless statements or false statements. So they did distinguish there. And what came out of this case is what's called the Pickering test, and this sort of becomes the key employment test when it comes to First Amendment expression. And so under the Pickering test, there are three elements. I've got these on slide 41. Did the speech address a matter of public interest and concern? Okay. Was the speech a significant or motivating factor in the employer's decision to discipline or terminate the employee? And in this case, the court found that, yeah, absolutely. You know, the school's reactions were in a direct result of the letter. Thirdly, did the court balance the interests of the individual commenting on matters of public interest and public concern, and the public employer's interest in promoting the efficiency of the public service? And so there is a balancing test here, and that gets into the recklessness and the false statements, and what is the effect of those statements in terms of promoting efficiency of public service. And so, in other words, there is an out there. There can be cases where the speech would not be protected under that third prong. So the Pickering test kind of evolved out of this 1968 case and still remains good law today. All right. Another case that often gets talked about in conjunction with Pickering is the Connick v. Myers case. This was in 1983, quite some time after the Pickering case. And here we had, this is down in the Bayou Country in New Orleans, Sheila Myers. She was an assistant district attorney in the Orleans Parish, and she had been transferred by her boss and out of one division into another, and she really, really did not want to be transferred. And so one of the things that she did is she sort of created this questionnaire for some of her colleagues about her boss and his management practices. And so she sent this questionnaire around, you know, sort of implying that he was not a very good boss and that that he was wrong for, you know, shifting people around. It was going to, you know, hurt the office. And when the boss found out about it, he fired her. Said that the questionnaire created a mini insurrection in the office and compromised his ability to run the office effectively. So those are the facts of that case. In the lower courts, they found in favor of Myers. They used the Pickering test. You know, the ability of her to do her job as an assistant district attorney, they argued, was of public importance, public interest. Was she fired directly for sending the questionnaire around? Yes. And then had they gone through this balancing test of her First Amendment rights versus the efficiency of the workplace. The Myers' boss, a man named Harry Connick, and incidentally, if that name is familiar to you, this is Harry Connick Jr.'s father, the musician, actually. He was the district attorney of the Orleans Parish back in the late 60s. He was the one who fired her. And when this case made its way to the Supreme Court, they actually reversed the lower court's findings. It was a 5-4 decision. And here's what they said. They said, when employee expression cannot be fairly considered as relating to any matter of political, social, or other concern to the community, government officials should enjoy wide latitude in managing their offices without intrusive oversight by the judiciary in the name of the First Amendment. Justice White wrote the majority opinion there. And so here is the key finding, is that what she was doing was of no public interest. It was internal. The court found that this was internal to the workings of that particular office. It was not a matter of public concern. And so it, under the Pickering test, which the court did agree was the appropriate test, it failed the first prong. And the idea here was that it didn't really matter whether Myers was transferred. These things were not going to affect the public at large in terms of how this office did its business with the courts. And so they ruled that under the Pickering test that her behavior was protected. So we see there sort of the Pickering test at work. Little footnote to this, in my research, I discovered that both Connick and Myers still worked together in the Orleans District for quite some time and moved on to other things and occasionally worked together on different occasions after that. And so it ended up being a pivotal case, but also a case where both of these people continued to work together after this for quite some time. A couple of other cases that I'll hit real quickly on here. The Rankin versus McPherson case. This was where a matter of presumably public concern protects a government's employee's First Amendment right to free speech as long as that employee is not in a policymaker role. And here's where they drill down a little bit further and they start distinguishing, okay, it is a matter of public importance, but is this person in a position where they are affecting public policy? In the Waters v. Churchill case, here was where, an employer is overheard saying something, and it's not even in writing now, and can that person be fired for a statement that they just say to somebody that's overheard by their boss? That's an interesting idea, and can they be fired for that? The answer is no. In the Garcetti versus Sabalos case, this was a legal opinion written in a memo, and that there is no First Amendment protection for speech made pursuant to official job duty. So if it's something that is stated in writing and it's a part of official job duties, you do not enjoy the First Amendment protections that you would as if you were expressing an offhanded opinion. So those are some other cases that have occurred. I need to mention the Mount Healthy case. This one is interesting because it's similar to Pickering in the sense that you have a teacher again fired from his job, and here instead of writing a letter to the editor, he called into a radio station and criticized the school district's implementation of a dress code for teachers. And he was fired, but the school board's defense was this guy was going to be fired anyway, whether he had made this call into the radio station or not. And so in First Amendment cases, this is known as the Mount Healthy defense, where the employer has the opportunity to prove that the discharge would have occurred no matter what, even if the employee had not engaged in protected speech. And the court did agree that the call into the radio station, just like in Pickering, would have been protected under the Pickering test. However, here you have the case where, well, what if the employee had done other things that warranted firing? Does the First Amendment protection of the speech provide you, sort of a get out of jail free ticket? And the answer is no. I've got a little slide here on slide 46. Now we're moving into the social media aspects a little bit, and I don't know, just thought it was funny that, unemployable due to stupid personal stuff. I put on my Facebook page, me too. For me, it was an embarrassing YouTube video. There's no question now in today's world that your Facebook profile can get you into some real trouble. And it's an increasing practice among employers to check potential employees' social media and see what kinds of stuff they're putting out there. And in many ways, in many unspoken ways, it can be a factor in whether a person gets hired. I've even read about in some cases where employers are asking for passwords to social media accounts, and that's become a question: is that permissible under the law? Different discussion for a different day, but there's no doubt that social media, in terms of the employee workplace, is a very real thing. It's not going away anytime soon. I bring up a couple other cases that have to do with the internet. We've looked at letters to the editor. We've looked at speaking to somebody and having it overheard. We've looked at phone calls into a broadcasted radio show. We've looked at a variety of other media. So how does the internet or social media figure in? I think it's probably pretty obvious now by now that the internet, just like I brought up earlier in the Reno case, is treated just like any other print media or visual media. And so these cases impact the way we view social media as well. In the Ashcroft versus the Free Speech Coalition case in 02, this is one I kind of offer it as a brief aside, but that there was a law banning virtual pornography, and I guess it was cartoons or something. I'm a little naive on this, but the idea there is that they couldn't ban it because this idea that though it was controversial, it was still an expression of an artistic expression is what the argument was. Now, whether or not it survives the obscenity test, I don't know. Under the American Library Association case, the Congress could require the nation's libraries to filter internet access on their computers. And that's another interesting aside. And that was allowable because the idea that children could be using those machines. What about threats, threatening language? A couple of interesting cases here. In 2015, the Alanis case, This is really the first social media case, I think, that the court had to deal with in 2015. There's some interesting facts here. Alanis was going through a divorce, and so he decided he was going to write a rap song about what he was going through. And his lyrics depicted violence towards women. He depicted violence towards his wife. Even saying in the lyrics, and I'm quoting here, "Art is about pushing limits. I'm willing to go to jail for my constitutional rights. Are you?" And then he had subsequent posts where he talked about harming children and law enforcement. Apparently, in his rap lyrics, he had made a comment about hurting kindergartners, sort of a la Sandy Hook, hurting children. And so the FBI paid him a visit, and after the FBI had come to talk to him, he decided that he would post about that and sort of hinted at harming FBI agents. And so the question before the court is, can a person who's making threats like this in the context of art or rap lyrics have a speech curtailed? What happened is Alanis was indicted on 5 counts of threats across state lines because it was the internet. He was convicted on 4 of those, sentenced to 44 months in prison. And the ruling statute here was federal statute saying it's a federal crime to transmit in interstate commerce any communications containing any threat to injure the person of another. This was eventually appealed all the way up to the Supreme Court. And they reversed the lower court's decision. And here we're back to, you know, basic 101 criminal law. And what the court said here is that there was no mens rea to commit the crime, that there was no intent to actually follow through with these things, that they were mere threats, okay? And the court was careful to point out that negligence in making a threat is not sufficient for intent. So in other words, he could have been careless, acting in poor taste, but those in and of themselves are not sufficient to constitute intent to commit the acts. And so there, again, statements made in social media posts are pretty much treated the same way that the print media cases and have been treated under those the line of cases that I've just taken you through. So back to the question I brought up earlier is you know, when you click the like button on Facebook, first of all, does that constitute speech? And if it does that constitute protected speech under the First Amendment? So the Bland v. Roberts case, Fourth Circuit case in 2013, the answer here on slide 50 to end the suspense is yes. A Facebook like is protected speech. This was a case where a person had gone onto a political candidate's Facebook page and liked something, clicked the like button. And turns out that the person they worked for was that political candidate's opponent, and when he found out about it, he fired the employee. And so the court said that liking a political candidate's page in this particular set of facts was protected speech, and that it was the internet equivalent of displaying a political sign in one's front yard. And the court has held that that is substantive speech. That was one of the arguments, that the like wasn't substantive speech, wasn't an actual expression. But it is, and it was, and they likened it to putting a political sign in your own yard. And so so we know that when you go on Facebook and that you click the like button, you're engaging in expression, and that expression is actually protected. But you might like to know that. Summing up our thoughts on this, we've looked at two key areas. The way that schools treat free speech under social media and other medias, and the way employers treat employee speech in print media and social media. And so just some general thoughts I can give you just from having looked through all this myself, that Tinker, Frazier, Hazelwood, Morse, those key threaded cases are alive and well today. Those are the standards that schools are held to in terms of how they evaluate. In my particular experience, I've been privy to a number of instances where the school has disciplined students for things that have occurred on social media, and the idea is that they are acting under this Tinker standard. For employees, the Pickering and Myers cases are still the cases that control these issues. When it comes to social media, particularly if those actions occur away from the workplace or off school grounds, not during school hours or not during the workday hours, that does not mean that you have carte blanche to say or do whatever you will with regard to what you say on social media. We do know that the Tinker standard will apply for material and substantial disruption. We do know that the Pickering test will apply where it needs to be a matter of social interest, and it needs to be something that concerns the public at large. And so there are limits on it. And so these limitations are in place and, for the most part, provide the court with some balance. It comes back to, you can't say anything that you want. However, your First Amendment rights are very much alive and well. That kind of gives you sort of the overview in terms of how First Amendment is to be treated in workplace environments and in school environments where you have government actors involved. We didn't have time to get into the way that the private employers are required to act. But as I pointed out to you, they're under, Title VII and, under the NLRA and other things like that. The employers, private employers, have been regulated as well. Different cases, different standards, but the idea is that First Amendment commerce, if you will, continues to be very important. It is something that the courts here, as I mentioned earlier today, in this term of the Supreme Court, several First Amendment cases, several social media cases are coming before the courts, and it's going to be very interesting to see how they rule and what the rationales are, whether or not they're relying on these bedrock cases. It's been great being a part of this and being able to kind of share what's out there and what's current. I hope you got a little something out of it yourself. And again, my name is Sean Scapoletto, and I work for Cobb, Dill & Hammett Law Firm here in Mount Pleasant, South Carolina. And I appreciate you taking the time to watch.